to go. I'm honored. This has just been a great day. It's just great to see so many of you here. So many of you who made this day possible. And just time spent in study when we're with other Christians. It's just always great. Always great. So it's been a great day. You know what we were talking about earlier? A friend suggested this, and she was right. You know, no matter, girls, what you guys are doing right, and you are, you're doing lots right. Sometimes even if we make the best choices and do what's right, even sometimes evil will happen. And that's the world we live in, because the devil is alive and working, and that is real. He is real, and he creates evil. And sometimes bad things will still happen no matter how hard we're doing the right thing. No, that is not your fault. That is not your fault. It is never your fault when other people choose to do evil. Okay? So that is very important that we talk about and that you know. God is faithful. And bad things are going to happen to us. That's the world we live in. Which makes our reward even that much sweeter. But bad things will happen sometimes. God is faithful to us. And we can just as Miss Jolene just talked about how God rips out the page, we can always be pure in His sight, no matter what has ever happened in the past. And don't ever forget that. That could be torn out, never to be seen again. And that is the God we serve. And that is awesome. And don't ever forget that, no matter what has happened. Your past does not define who you are. You can change that at any time. And I don't ever want to not say something like that. Always remember that and help others to see that as well. And that's the beauty of what we have together, to be able to talk about that and see that. And we see that in Scripture. And that is a beautiful part of our story. We talked about the first session earlier, what was your story online? We're going to kind of flip to what is your story at school? What is your story at school? Who do your friends see when they see you? What do they know that you're all about? Like, what are the things you talk about with them, you do with them, you want to do with them? What do they know you to be? What do they know that you're a Christian? How do they know you're a Christian? How do you treat others around them? How do you treat them? Are you the encourager of the group? Or do you put people down behind their backs and engage in the latest gossip? Or are you the one that says, well, I don't know if that's true. Let's not spread that. What do they know you as? Do you take note of your friends and their struggles? Are you encouraging them? Do you ask them about the things that they are dealing with in their lives? And do they know how much you care about them? How do you do your schoolwork? Do you take tests with integrity? Do you help friends as needed, or do you give them the cold shoulder? Do your friends see someone who always takes time to notice maybe someone who's lonely or is not with anyone else? And what would others say that you think is important? Boys, cars, God, the Bible, the Lord's church. It's always good for everybody to take kind of a self-inventory. Look into yourself, notice good things, and notice things that might need to change. Romans 8, 5 and 6 says, "For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace." And in Mark 7, 20 through 23, Jesus said, "What comes out of a person defiles him. For from within, out of people's hearts, come evil." evil thoughts, immoralities, thefts, murders, adulterers, greed, evil actions, deceit, promiscuity, stinginess, blasphemy, pride, and foolishness. All these evil things come from within and can defile a person. Luke 6:31 says, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Proverbs 18:24 says, there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. Proverbs 19:20, listen to advice and accept discipline. And at the end, you will be counted among the wise. A good question to ask is, do your friends see you as a pure, devoted Christian? Devoted to something much, much bigger than you are? Are you representing Christ in the time at school that you have with these friends? At school functions, playing sports with these girls? You know, y'all are at an awesome time in your life where you're with these friends all the time. You're not ever going to have this again. You're with them all day at school. You get to go play sports with them or do extracurricular activities with them. You get to spend the night with them. You get to go on trips with them. You're with them all the time. You have an opportunity that you may never have again in your life to reach them for God. You are with them so much. It is an awesome opportunity. Jesus showed us what true purity in our friendships look like. John 15:13 says, greater love has no one than this, than someone lay down his life for his friend. We know that Jesus was our perfect and pure example in everything. And we are to pattern our lives as closely to his as we can. We know we're never going to make it, but as closely as we can, trying every day to do better. And we're going to be blessed for doing that, and we're going to be able to bless others for doing that as well. You know, there was a song years ago that said, if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. We must prepare ourselves to be strong and be ready for temptations when they come. And how you're going to handle it. When I was in 7th or 8th grade, I was with one of my friends, and we were in our church building, and she said, do y'all have a piano in here? And I said, no. And she said, why? And I kind of froze, and I was about 7th grade, and I didn't give a good answer at all, and I thought, man, I missed the opportunity, and that taught me a lesson to be prepared for what I need to say. Why do I believe what I believe? You guys study. Know and be confident and sure so you can tell when hard questions come your way what you're believing in. And let them see that you're standing for something much bigger than you alone. You know, when Jesus handled temptation, he said it is written. And he went back to the words of God. And so that is what we do also. In Galatians chapter 5, we read of the fruits of the Spirit. And this is what's going to come out of us when we're putting in those good things. That purity of God's Spirit living in us will come out. Love, joy, peace, patience, and so on. And we can lead others to have these blessings when we have it too. Now, the few verses next are the works of the flesh. And it says the works of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, moral impurity, promiscuity, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambitions, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and anything similar. I tell you about those things in advance. As I told you before, those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Proverbs 13:20 says, walk with the wise and become wise. For a companion of fools suffers harm. You know, I like that Miss Joanne mentioned how important our friends are. Because they are that important. In 2 Corinthians 6:14, it says, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers, for what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship? fellowship has light and darkness. You know, if the only people that we choose to hang out with are people that don't have our same values and don't believe in God and don't really care about morals or standards that God has, we might not be able to be as strong as we could be if we were with stronger people. Now, we can and will and should have friends who are not Christian. It's our job to teach them and bring them to Him. We must do that. However, we also really need that encouragement and support and strength from stronger Christians. So be careful. Those who will support our decisions and help us when we notice take a stand for something we shouldn't be a part of, to help us be pure. It will help to have others who are there too, saying, no. So it is important. And I just want to let you know, it's really more important to have just a few strong, faithful Christian friends than many friends of this world. Be careful about your friends. And you see in the illustration, and if we had a chair, I would do it. Oh, we gotta do it. All right, I need a volunteer. Would some of you guys help me? Okay, whichever one y'all can find, come on up. I need a helper. Okay, good. I bet you've seen this before, but you need to see it. Look at that. Awesome. Okay, I want you to stand in this chair. I promise I won't hurt you or anything. All right. Now, can you turn around and like say, okay, here we go. All right, with one hand, I want you to pull me up into the chair with you. Go. Oh, come on, you can do it. Is this working very good? Okay. Oh, I pulled her down pretty quickly, right? Yeah. It's so much harder to pull people up than to pull them down. So don't ever forget that. It can be done, and it's our job to try and to do that. But it's a lot harder to pull someone up. Thank you very much. So be careful about your friends. It does make a difference. Think about and answer those questions today. What are you portraying in front of your friends every day? They are with you all the time. They see how you treat everybody. They know what y'all talk about. They know where you go. They know what you do because they're with you. So be careful and think about that. Are you showing purity in all those areas of your life? What are you doing really good? Celebrate it. Be thankful for it. Keep doing what you're doing. What are you doing that might need to improve? And make those changes. Now we're going to look at what's your story in your home congregations, in the Lord's church. Do you know the other kids in the youth group? I mean, really know them. Are you an active, vital part of the Lord's work? It looks like you guys. Do you encourage others in your youth group? Do you know other ladies and older gentlemen in the congregation and those who aren't your same age? I believe we've got that going on here, which is amazing to see. Do you take part in learning about all the members of the church, no matter their age? Are you bringing your friends to be a part of the Lord's church? Work, youth activities, worship services. You are so important to the Lord. At your age, you are so important to Him, and you are a vital part of His work here on this earth. And you were created, and I was created, for His purpose. In Ephesians 2, verse 10, we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. You know, the Bible makes it very clear that He created man and He created us for His glory. You know, we're not here just to get all this good stuff to happen to us and have it great and just see how far we can go ourselves. That's really not why we're here. Sometimes that's kind of what we strive for. And there's nothing wrong with that, but we must remember our ultimate purpose. while we're here, so that we can go and be with him in glory one day. Proverbs 19:21 says, many are the plans in a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that always prevails. You know, nowadays you hear of so many that say they love the Lord, they love God, but they don't want anything to do with the church, his bride that he died for. And I don't quite understand that, because that can't be when the Lord laid his life down for his church, his family. We have to love his family just as much. And those who have put on Christ have become pure and clean and free from sin, and we are his bride, his family. We must love him, the Lord's church, take care of it, and bring as many others to it as we can. We must show others that there's something different and special and pure about the Lord's church, in hopes that they will want what we have. It is a blessing to come together as a group of people that love and worship him. Like today, this is a blessing. I've been encouraged seeing this many people here. You guys have worked so hard. That is encouraging to all of us that are in this room to make a day like this happen, that this is that important. And it is. And that you are taking time to do it. You know, other people can spot a fake pretty easily. And I think that's part of where our purity needs to come to in play. If we are not genuine, if we are not sincere, and if we don't live like we say we do, they're going to know that. And why do they want to be a part of that? If it doesn't mean that much to you, why should it mean that much to me? That's really important to think about. You know, I went to New York with my oldest a few months ago on a senior trip, and we went to Chinatown and got these purses. We had so much fun. It was a little crazy there. Some of you may have been. But I got this fake Kate Spade purse. You know, we just thought we were just great because we kind of haggled them down and we had so much fun, and they're not real. But I have this fake Kate Spade purse. Well, a friend of mine from church has a real one just like my little fake one. And you can tell a little difference in the label. The rest of it, if you're not looking close, you're not going to be able to tell. But if you look really close, you notice. People can spot whether we're genuine and pure or not. Pretty easy. Just like we can spot that in someone else. And so it's important for us to be who we say we are and to show that and try to look like Christ as much as we can. Let others see what purity looks like in this world when purity isn't what this world is about, and shine for him. Ecclesiastes 12:13-14, King Solomon, who was wealthy and had anything he wanted, tried living for his own pleasure. And yet at the end of his life, he concluded that the only life worthwhile is one of honor and obedience to God. That's all that really matters. And that's what we should be focused on and keep reminding ourselves all the time that that's our main purpose and most important. All right, now we're going to flip. We've looked at what's your story online. What is your story at school with your friends? What is your story in the congregation with the Lord's church? And lastly, let's look at the real you. What is your real story? You know, these are some deep questions I hope that you've asked yourself, and I've asked myself today, about who we really are. It involves an image that we are portraying, whether we're real, whether we're not pure, the real thing, or fake, which is not genuine. Today is about purity and living that focus of just being pure that comes from our heart. I want us, instead of focusing so much on Instagram, to focus on your inner gram. Focus on your inner gram. 1 Samuel 16:7, the Lord said to Samuel, do not look on his appearance or the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. You know, we do look on the heart. We look on the outward appearance. We're guilty of that. I know I am a lot, because that's what we see. It's the first one thing we see. We don't always have the opportunity to see someone's heart like God does. God sees hearts. And sometimes we make assumptions on what we've seen and what we've heard, and we may not always be able to look at the heart first. So we can make slip-ups. But God doesn't. And aren't we thankful? God sees what's in our heart. We must be careful about when we portray ourselves and put ourselves out there, when we're branding ourselves. If we're not trying to, even if we're not trying to reveal of what others see, that they see the real us, that we are Christians. First and foremost, we wear his name, and he went to the cross for us. And the pain of our sins was on him. And we must make him proud to have been through that for us. 1 Peter 3:3-4 says, do not let your adorning be external. The braiding of hair, putting on the gold jewelry, the clothes that we wear, but let it be the hidden person of the heart, with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's eyes is very precious. We were created in God's image. God makes no mistakes. To put yourself down for the way you are is to insult God's handiwork. You are beautiful. Ephesians 2:10, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. Proverbs 31:30, charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord shall be praised. Now, if you were at CYC, those of you who went a few weeks ago, Ralph Gilmore said this: if you're comparing yourself to all the other people out there, there's always going to be someone better than you are. There's always going to be someone prettier. There's always going to be someone stronger. There's always going to be someone faster. There's always going to be someone more athletic, more studious, and better at academics. Always. Right? So don't compare. God made you the way you are for his purpose. And he has a plan for you. Be the most amazing you that you can be. Find things that you're really good at. As you're developing your talents and growing, find what you're really good at. God has given you so many abilities, and it's really neat to be able to find those and use them for his glory. You know, when I was just a little bit older than you guys, maybe you guys over here, I had just turned 19, and I had been a freshman at Free Hardeman that year. And I had some pain in my side and right here, and I thought, oh, that's weird, whatever. I had felt some hardness in my asthma, and I thought, well, I'm going to do knee sit-ups, that's weird, oh well. So I let months go by, and near the end of the semester, I was with John one day, and we were at worship, and I almost felt like I was going to pass out. And I thought, that's weird. That's really weird. I've never felt like that before. Long story short, I ended up having a very big tumor right there, the size of a watermelon, on my ovary. And I had just turned 19. And I was put straight into the hospital. I thought I had a kidney infection. I went to the doctor for that. And they put me straight in the hospital and said, you've got a tumor that's got to come out. 2 days later, they sent me up to Nashville to meet an oncologist. Well, in my knowledge, there wasn't any talk of cancer, but because of the size of the tumor, they wanted me to see an oncologist to do my surgery. And so, that night in the hospital, I'm meeting this doctor who I didn't know, trying to process 2 days of tests and crazy, and figure out what was going on. with a tumor. And the Lord spared me that. And I was feeling pretty sorry for myself in the hospital because I have a scar from here down where they cut me 2 days after my surgery. And I finally got the nerve to look at my scar. And I was just feeling really sorry for myself because this is going to look so ugly and I'm devastated. 19. And so I looked at it. And I wasn't happy. And I was feeling sorry for myself again. And then my doctor walked in that very day, not too long after that. And I remember it like yesterday. It was 20 plus years ago. And he said, parts of your tumor were found cancerous. And you're going to have to go to chemotherapy. And you're going to lose all your hair. And I felt pretty silly for being sorry for myself for the scar at that moment. Because that scar was why I'm probably here today. And anyway, long story short, I went through those chemo treatments, and it's pretty tough at 19 to look at yourself in the mirror, thin and pale, without any hair on your head, trying to figure out who you are. Because before that, I was thinking hair made me who I was. I got to fix it every day. I had bad hair days. And I looked at the outward appearance a whole lot. I was not confident in who I was. And I put a lot of emphasis on outward appearance and what others thought of me, as most teenagers do. And I had to learn who I was, looking at myself like that. Knowing this didn't make me. And I believe God made a work happen in me that I'm thankful for. And as James says, count it joy when you enter trials. I'm thankful that I went through that because I came out way more confident than I've ever been in my life, knowing who I really was. And I admit I'm a girly girl and I like doing girl stuff just as much as the next one. But I know without a doubt that does not make me who I am at all. I share that with you in hopes that you won't have to look at yourself in the mirror to figure out who you are. And not compare yourself to everyone out there. And worry about that. Focus on your inner, not the outward appearance. You know, being pure and having a pure heart shows in everything that you do. And confidence in that is a blessing. And knowing that you're still the same person, even though you don't have hair on your head at 19 years old, that's a pretty big thing, and I'm thankful I was able to learn that. But I share that just so you guys will think about that. You are precious and special. No matter what your hair looks like, no matter what the past has been like for you, no matter what you've been through, that does not define who you are. Jeremiah 1:5 says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Galatians 6:3 says, for if anyone thinks he is something, he is nothing. He deceives himself. Ephesians 2:4 and 5 says, but God being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. And by grace, you have been saved. We are defined. And we are defined, you know, the world defines us by our body shape and physical beauty. And tells us that's what's important. And Ms. Joanne touched on that. Magazines, social media, news, it's all around us. And it's hard for women. But by God, we're defined because he formed you and he made you. By the world, we're defined by our physical or intellectual ability, what we can or can't do. And by God's standards, he gives us strength and wisdom. By the world's standards, we're defined by our popularity. loves us no matter what. By the world standards, we're defined by our wealth, or what we have, or what we don't have. But by God, He provides for us. He gives us everything we need. Maybe not everything we want, but everything we need. And by the world standard, the taste, and that can ravage our life. But God, He gives us life. And He died for us. And there's nothing more beautiful than that. And 1 Peter 3:4, again, I love this verse. I know we've already used it several times. Let your beauty be found in the hidden person of the heart, with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. You know, nobody can take that from you. No matter whether you have hair on your head or not. Girls, an accident can happen. Things can happen and can take that from you. But no one can take who you are from you. No one. We're not defined by our outward appearance. And our value and worth is not measured by what we look like. We are made in the image of God. And thank goodness, He can make us pure. He can make us white as snow. We cannot be that on our own, but He can make us that. And we are clean, not because of anything you or I do, but because He did it for us. He shed His blood for us so that we can live and not die. I will sanctify my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, which you have profaned in their midst. And the nations shall know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God, when I am hallowed in you before their eyes. Ezekiel 36:23. When we share Him with other people, hopefully they will see Him through us and give Him the glory, which is our goal. I would say that those things can give us a life filled with purity. A pure life inside and outside is happy, and it is strong, and it has no regrets at all. No regrets. That's pretty awesome. It's a life that can bring others to Him and is praised by the Lord. Just take note of all the things we've looked at today. How close are we to those women in scriptures that we read about? Think of Mary. How close are we to them? What is our life like on social media? Are you photoshopping yourself and failing like the pictures we looked at the beginning? So much that you can't be recognized for who you really are. Do you know your real worth in the eyes of God? If your pure identity is in trouble, in Philippians 1:6, it says, He who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. He has begun a good work in all of us. And we're a work in progress, as I like to say. And God will complete it in the end. If your heart has been touched today by things that we've talked about and studied,